NASCAR director, who's going to give us a presentation about how the government as well as the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, we are also, how we are all going together and work out to ensure that children with disabilities are also part of the educational system in the context of this COVID situation. So I should think so, Dr. Reju Palmer, and then I would request Dr. Reju to take over and speak on the issue, please. Thank you.
Good morning to all. Are we starting or should we wait?
We are good to start, sir. We are good to start.
Okay. I don't have a structured presentation with me.
Not really.
I will just share my thoughts in this particular thing. As probably many others, the department per se, and we all are struggling to figure out what is ahead. We were examining various options, considering the social maintenance of the social norms in the schools. So far we were planning how much curriculum we can probably reduce so that the available school days can be planned accordingly. And since the last academic year had to be stopped in between, we could not complete our annual exams, especially the annual 10th class board exams. So we were busy in organizing all these things. Now, we have planned the SSLC exam that will be starting in 25th of this month, and that will be over by July 5th. And then we will have the evaluation process, wherein most of our teachers in the secondary schools, they will be slightly busy. So for me, there are four major points or major themes that will be important for the next school year. I will try to connect these four points vis-a-vis the how we are going to relate that particular thing with the children with the special needs. One is giving flexibility for the schools to adopt a particular model. One thing we realize, suppose even for an argument, if we reduce the curriculum by half, then probably we need half many school days compared to a typical academic year, that is 40 days. In Karnataka, considering the number of children in the schools, we hope that we will be able to conduct the schools without any shift system or without any without shift system for a large number of schools. But still there will be probably 25 to 30% of the schools where we will not have enough classrooms or enough teachers to have classes for all days if the social distancing norms to be followed. It means 50% of the to work in the 50% of the reduced capacity. So in some schools, we may need to give a shift system so that the social distancing norms of 15 to 20 children per school to be maintained. It means for some schools, there is a possibility of running every day, even with the reduced syllabus, but maintaining social distancing. But for some schools, it may not be possible. So we are considering to offer a bouquet of solutions to, or bouquet of models to schools, and the schools will in turn decide what model they will be adapting. Whether they want to do a shift system, say morning and afternoon, or it is in the alternate days, or it is the continuous days, but in the first half. So we are trying to offer a bouquet of models to the individual. So there will be some flexibility for the individual schools to decide. Second thing is the micro planning. What we saw or what we are seeing now with the SSLC exam, we had suggested the teachers in who are taking classes in 10th grade or 10th standard and high schools to connect to all schools, all children studying in 10th standard. And if you take the numbers, on an average, one teacher was supposed to connect to 10 to 15 children, only that much, especially in the government schools. So, so far that micro planning, in the sense, you know, every teacher linking or talking to or contacting the students, it is going well. It is not only that whether they are continuing studies, it was also about, you know, how they will come to the examination center, what kind of support they need, a kind of support for revising the subjects, etc. So what we feel is this micromanagement of individual schools, whereby teachers will be in contact with the children, that is working now, as of now, maybe because again a small number, but we feel, you know, even if it is extended to all grades, it will work. Again, probably we have a many schools with less number of children, so we hope on an average a particular teacher will have to be in touch with probably 30 to 35 children. It may vary from region to region. In those cases, we may recruit guest teachers, but eventually one teacher will be able to be in touch with less than 40 children. The fourth thing is, we will be trusting a lot more in our teachers. I mean, in this chaotic situation and where the situation is continuously evolving, and again, situation of particular area may be very, very different from the areas in the places in the same district. Probably we feel that a lot of trust needs to be put in teachers, and we will be giving general framework and guidelines for the teachers to handle the situation. And the fourth thing is to increase the community connection and network. Now, the disinfection or continuous maintenance of the personal hygiene, etc., it may not be possible with the resources and with the human resources available with the department only. Probably a lot of support are needed from the Grama Panchayat, across the departments and the community. So ensuring the community support and monitoring will be the fourth thing. So these four things will define the next academic year, in my opinion. That is offering a different models for the schools to take one model. Then micro planning, whereby each and every child will be contacted by a particular teacher, and one teacher continue to be a mentor for the entire year, next academic year 2021, giving a lot of responsibility and support for the teachers, and ensuring the community connect. These things will be define the year. See, if I take children with special needs, even though many people feel that we are yet to identify many more children, but as of now, officially, we have around 90,000 children. So per block, if I divide the 90,000 numbers by 204 blocks, it is coming around some 441 children. Even if I take only the special teachers, BIRTs alone, one BIRT will have to be in touch with 100 children. So out of 100 children, probably some of them may be contacted over a phone or probably some digital means also. But probably for the majority of the children who may not be able to be communicated through a digital mode, we are asking the teachers to be directly in touch with them. After seeing the SSLC experiment, I feel confident that our teachers will be definitely able to do that. In many districts, especially in the remote blocks, we could see that teachers were in constant touch with the children, visiting their houses again and again. They visited the houses of the children not only as part of the surveys given by the health department or the district administration, but otherwise also. We will also ensure that, you know, the parents will be in touch with the school, that regular schools, even though the schools may not start regularly. For example, this week, we had asked all our teachers to have try to have class-wise parents meeting. So it will be arranged in a staggered manner. So this week they will be coming to the schools just to be in touch, to start talking with, start engaging about the next academic year to the schools. Next week again, we will be distributing the midday meal ration. So again, they will be coming to the schools to collect that. Probably by third week, they will be again coming to the schools for collecting the textbooks. So in a regular manner, they will be in touch with our school authorities. Now, coming to the online education, we had done a quick survey. I won't say it was a census-based survey. More or less, it was a kind of a sample survey only. From the sample survey, what we felt is the reach or availability of mobile devices are much, much lesser than we thought. And even the smart gadgets are also, their availability also much, much lesser compared to probably many other states. Say, for example, in Kerala, where only probably less than 8 or 9% children are not having the gadgets. So we will be probably using TV and radio as a medium for the interim engagement of children. It is not that we will be start teaching all those things you be Doordarshan or all. It will be a kind of primary we use as a meet children. For the first 1 month, it will be a kind of a bridging sessions, a kind of recap of what they all learned, again through very, very light formats, whether it is stories, songs, activities, etc. These will be broadcast centrally, and the very same things will be shared with the mentoring teacher which I mentioned earlier. So we will try whether that is working. I mean, some content is getting broadcast centrally, and a particular teacher who was supposed to take care of the 20 to 30 children, whether they are able to connect to those children referring this particular content. So if it works, probably, I mean, that we will continue until the school reopens. And once the school reopens, probably with the reduced curriculum, we may move to the more mainstream teaching. Now, with regard to the one more point I would like to flag is the content. Now we realize, I mean, we had a number of content with us already until last year. But we realize that these contents may not be very useful to engage children. Our content was basically more in the format of assessments or examples or some activity videos. That alone may not be enough for handling the children for the entire academic year. We are actually in the process of creating more content. We are trying to source the content. We are trying to crowdsource it. So as of now, we don't have a specific content exclusively for children of those children who belong to a particular category or a children with a specific disability. Probably that we need to work together to create that kind of a content and ensure that these contents are available offline and online, and probably training all our teachers to be familiar with this kind of content. So probably with regard to the children with the special needs, what I feel we will start working with the online training of teachers. I mean, what we saw in the last 2 months, especially in the lockdown months, we saw a lot of training that is happening online by teachers themselves. A lot of Nallikali groups, especially in North Karnataka, we saw they are actively coming together to have courses or trainings happening online. We also subject teachers. I mean, other than the 10th grade itself, there was a lot of subject teachers forum being in continuously in touch with each other and learning many, many more things. And in SSLC also, we noticed that a lot many teachers, whether they are from rural area or in urban area, they were in touch with each other and they were offering training to the children. So online training of teachers may be the first thing to consider, which we plan to do probably parallelly or probably by the end of this month. And parallelly, we will also do mapping the children with the teachers. So these two activities we hope to complete by July 1st week or July 15th. And once that happens, probably we will start understanding the status of each and every child, including the children with special needs. And then probably we will be able to start the next academic year. Just to update, put it in the wider context, actually we, Karnataka had the project appraisal board meeting of MHRD last month. MHRD was ready to support and approving whatever interventions we were proposing. One of the proposal was to refurbishing the block level resource centers. So we submitted as a kind of an innovative or a piloting proposal, and MHRD agreed for trying out in 10 block level resource centers. So I hope that also we will be trying to undertake in the first 2-3 months itself. So this is a quick summary of things. Probably the Department of Primary and Secondary Education, State of Karnataka, will try to do. I am also realizing that, you know, this may be a bit over ambitious given the limitations in terms of movements, limitations in terms of resources, especially the financial resources. But I hope over the months we will be able to overcome the limitations, and we will be able to offer a better academic year for all children, each and every children of the state, including children with the special needs. Over to you, Ravi.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. That was a very detailed presentation. The SSA has really thought a lot about what is necessary for the children with special needs. And let us hope that all of us players, the NGOs, the officers, all of us players, we can effectively make use of the ideas of the department and work effectively to see that children with special needs are not left behind in the educational process. Thank you once again, sir. Thank you very much individually as well as from the department, sir. Thank you once again, please. Namaste.
Thank you, Dr. Raju. I just want to bring to know, to light the difficulties that not only our government or your department, but across the world, I think all of them are struggling with this. So it's not anything unique to us, so that we can come up with any quick fix solutions. But we are just very appreciative of the fact that all of this is comprehensively thought out, and there's a clear focus on children with special needs. We work very closely with your department, and we really know how much of effort the entire department puts to address the issues of children with special needs. So this webinar more or less is to bring to light, one, the understanding that we are really focused about creating a solution that our children with special needs won't be left behind. And whatever we do, we try to be inclusive in our approach. And your little sharing for the last 15 minutes has been insightful. We sometimes, as people who are working in the sector, need to be reassured
And that has come very clearly through the highest office at the SSA, you know, the desk. And this is greatly appreciated. Thanks for joining in. To the audience, Dr. Reju also has an appointment just after this with the VC or the Secretary of the MHRD, he says, primarily to discuss the very same issues. So we are hoping that things will pan out in the time to come. And so you can be on the call. I am sure there are a couple of questions addressed to you. And if you have to leave, we will actually have them sent to your office so you can actually send a response if anything is relevant. Otherwise, we as a team, the entire team of the disability sector that's joining, will try and address it to each other. And we will also give you some recommendations that might come out of this webinar. So
thank you, Diana. Unfortunately, I need to leave because the MHRD secretary's VC is on the very same issue, the guidelines to be issued for reopening the schools. Sure. This VC actually got postponed last week. So probably, you know, everybody is in utter confusion, you know, how to even the broader framework of guidelines to be issued. I hope today we will get a little more clarity. So anyway, my officers are in this group. My office people are also there. They will be also here. I wish I could hear Niranjan Aradhya, Sukanya from UNICEF and all others, Mr. Vesavaraj, etc. But anyway, they will be hearing it. Pardon me. I will be in touch with all of you. And definitely next year, we will be taking up all these, all our interventions or efforts in association, within consultation with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And this will be available on YouTube as a recording. So just in case your team wants to follow it up with the recommendations or anything that's important, that we'll make it available to everybody.
Okay. Thank you.
And anyway, we are in touch with the department. So anything, anytime you can ask us, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Ravi, if you want to concise it in Kannada for a few minutes and then we can take the next speaker.
Actually, SPD Sahebro, Ivat Nirvishtavagi Namma Sarkara Angavikala Makalige Namma Sarva Siksha Abhiyan Yariti Karikrama Marta Devi Rupasa Devi Anteli Adana Vati Hedadro Ada Sahebro Hedadanga. It is Iga Yeldru Karakulobeko. ಅವರ ಕೇಂದ್ರ ಬಿಂದುವಾಗಿರುವಂತಹ ಫೋಕಸ್ ಏನಿತ್ತು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಸಮನ್ವಯತೆ ನಾವು ಕಾಪಾಡ್ಕೋತಾ ಎಲ್ಲರನ್ನು ಒಳಗೊಂಡು ಹೋಗಬೇಕು. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಅಂಗವಿಕಲ ಮಕ್ಕಳು, ವಿಕಲಚೇತನ ಮಕ್ಕಳು, ವಿಶೇಷ ಅಗತ್ಯಗಳ ಮಕ್ಕಳು, ಅವರಿಗೆ ನಾವು ಹೊರತುಪಡಿಸಿ ನಾವು ಏನ್ ಮಾಡಕ್ ಬರುವುದಿಲ್ಲ. ಅದ್ರೊಳಗೆ ಅವರಂತ ನಿರ್ದಿಷ್ಟವಾಗಿ ತಮ್ಮ ಶಿಕ್ಷಕರು, ಈ ಸಮನ್ವಯ ಇರಬಹುದು ಅಥವಾ ರೆಗ್ಯುಲರ್ ಶಿಕ್ಷಕರು, ನಲಿಕಲಿ ಶಿಕ್ಷಕರು ಅಥವಾ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಹತ್ತನೇ ಉನ್ನತ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಹೈಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಶಿಕ್ಷಕರು, ಅವರು ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಯಾರೀತಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಒಳಗೊಂಡಂತೆ, ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ನಿರ್ದಿಷ್ಟವಾಗಿ ವಿಕಲಚೇತನ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಒಳಗೊಂಡಂತೆ ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ತಮ್ಮ ತಮ್ಮ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಒಳಗೆ ರೂಪಿಸಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಆ ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆ ಒಳಗೆ ನಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರ ಸಹಕಾರ, ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಸೇರಿ ಒಂದು ಪರಿಹಾರ ಕಾಣ್ಕೋಬಹುದು ಅನ್ನುವಂತ ಸರ್ಕಾರದ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಒಳಗ, ಸಮಾಜದ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಒಳಗ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಪಾಲಕರ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಒಳಗ ನಾವು ಮಾಡಬಹುದು ಅನ್ನುವಂತ ವಿಶ್ವಾಸನ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಪಡಿಸಿದ್ರು. ಓವರ್ ಡಯಾನಾ.
Mr. Basavaraj is on call. He's on standby, so you can introduce him and we can go to
Basavaraj sir. ನಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಚಿರಪರಿಚಿತರು. ಯಾಕಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಅವರು ನಮ್ಮ ಅಂಗವಿಕಲ ಚಳುವಳಿಯಿಂದ ಬಂದವರು. ಸರ್ ನಮಗಂತೂ ಸುಮಾರು ಒಂದು 15-20 ವರ್ಷ ಪರಿಚಯ. ನಮಗೇನೇ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆ ಇತ್ತಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು, ಮೊದಲನೇದಾಗಿ ನಾವು ನಿರೀಕ್ಷೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ವಿ ಅವರಿಗೆ. ಅವರು ಎನ್ ಜಿ ಒ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ನಮಗಂತೂ ತಲೆಯೊಳಗಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ, ಅವರು ಬೇರೆ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ನಮಗಂತೂ ತಲೆಯೊಳಗಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಯಾವುದೇ ನಮಗೆ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆ ಇತ್ತಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಬಸವರಾಜ ಸರ್ ಅವರೇ ನಾವು ಅವರಿಗಂತೂ ಹೋಗಿ ನಾವು ವೈಯಕ್ತಿಕವಾಗಿ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಿದ್ವಿ. ಈಗ ಅವರು ಕಮಿಷನರ್ ಆಗಿ ಬಂದಿದಾರಲ್ಲ, ನಮಗಂತೂ ಒಂದು ಬಹಳ ಬಲ ಬಂದಂಗೆ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಸೊ ಆ ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆ ಒಳಗೆ ನಾವೀಗ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಏನು ಹೇಳಿದ್ವಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ಅವರ ವಿಭಾಗ ಈ ಸಮಾಜದೊಳಗೆ ಏನೇನು ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಸಮುದಾಯಗಳದಾವೆ, ಪಾಲಕರಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಶಿಕ್ಷಕರಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಎಲ್ಲ ಸಮುದಾಯಕ್ಕೆ ಸಂಬಂಧಪಟ್ಟಂಗೆ ಇವತ್ತಿವರ ರಾಜ್ಯ ಮುಖ್ಯಸ್ಥರನ್ನ ಬಸವರಾಜ್ ಸರ್ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಅವರು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಅವರು ನಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಉದ್ದೇಶಿಸಿ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ಸ್ವಾಗತ ಸರ್, ಬನ್ನಿ. ಓವರ್ ಟು ಬಸವರಾಜ್ ಸರ್. ಬಸವರಾಜ್ ಸರ್,
ರವಿ ಹಿಸ್ ಲಾಗ್ಡ್ ಇನ್.
ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಫೋನ್ ಮಾಡ್ಲಿ.
ಅನ್ಮ್ಯೂಟ್ ಮಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಬಸವರಾಜ್ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್. ಇನ್ ದ ಮೀನ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಟು ದಿ ಆಡಿಯನ್ಸ್, we have a good representation today. We have over 128 people right now on the call from various parts of the country and outside as well, and a good representation from Karnataka. We are hoping that Mr. Basavaraj sharing will connect with all of our current issues and our questions. Is sir on call, or we can go to Sukanya ma'am for the next, by the time Mr. Basavaraj gets on? Sanjana, please, can you make a call?
Illa, that is not the number, ma'am.
Ravi, I think we should take it to Sukanya, ma'am.
Yes. Sukanya, madam, avaru UNICEF. Sukanya Martha, madam, avaru UNICEF ana pratinidhistha idare.
Sir, we are here. We are waiting for you to speak. We've introduced you.
Yes, sir.
Oh, can I go ahead?
Yes, sir. We can see you and you can speak to us.
Actually, ನಿಮ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಎಷ್ಟು ನಮಗೆ ಆಗ್ಬೇಕಾ ಹೊಗಳಿದ್ವಿ, ಆದ್ರೆ ನೀವ್
ಇಲ್ಲ ನಾನು ಕೇಳಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡೆ, ನೀವ್ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದು ಇದ್ದೆ ನಾನು, ಬಟ್ ಬೇರೆ ಫೋನ್ ತಗೊಂಡೆ, ಅದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಫಾಲೋ ಅಪ್ ಇತ್ತು ಫೋನ್. ಅದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ಕನ್ನಡ ಆಗ್ಬೋದಲ್ಲ, ಕನ್ನಡ ಆಗ್ಬೋದಲ್ಲ.
ಮಿಕ್ಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಗುಡ್ ಸರ್, ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸಮ್ ಇಂಟರ್ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಟಿಸಿಪೇಟ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಓಕೆ.
ವೆರಿ ಗುಡ್, ವೆರಿ ಗುಡ್. ಸೊ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಫೋರ್ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಎ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸೋ ಮಚ್ ಫಾರ್ ಆರ್ಗನೈಸಿಂಗ್ ದಿಸ್. ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಟೈಮ್ಲಿ and very very relevant. It's needed at this point in time. Dr. Reju is already explained what the department is trying to do and how it's going to address this issue. I fully agree with him. Avaru heladage there is some definitely concerns, and also kind of understanding that sector needs still has to evolve. My request to all the professionals and all the people is to keep it open and see how we can jointly work together, because the end goal of all of us is to see how best we could support our children with disability and the family, so that this year it's also a great learning opportunity according to me, because in a situation like this we will also learn very innovative things. I want people to keep it more open and see how we can evolve a whole new methodology so that it might improve the quality of education for children with disability in the mainstream sector better. So certainly I would trying to look at, I am working very closely with the department in 2-3 areas. Particularly I'm trying to closely work in terms of how to ensure that they have a deeper and a permanent system, and so that it is not one off. They need to put certainly a structure, and whatever the structure they have at one level it is okay, but they need to put a little bit more technical structure so that some kind of qualitative inputs can happen for children with disability. So government is very open, they are very keen to do that. So let's hope that we'll also work hand in hand to see how we could support that. For me, the biggest thing in this kind, of course, as Reju said, about 20 lakh plus children are there. But, you know, of this, about 65% of them are mild and moderate, you know, level of children. They need some support, and they can be supported with the mainstream setup itself. Question is, the children remaining about 30, 35 to 40% of the children who need little more intensive support within the education system, we need to really talk about that. Particularly, I have reviewed, I have seen that we need to equip the parents. We need to equip the siblings. I think they don't have much program, so we are pushing them to come up with some kind of a structured plan so that some partnership can build with the parents and the sibling, so that whatever the school can do, it can do, but I think it has to be compensated through parents and siblings support system, which is very, very critical according to me. Of course, a good idea is to you know, train teachers. As all of you know, just about 4 or 5 months ago, the government has now appointing about 816 permanently. All these years, these teachers were not permanent. So they were coming here and then go. But the government of Karnataka has sort of issued a GO ensuring that all these teachers will be permanent, so that some of these teachers are need to be retrained. So we are working with the government to see how we could retrain them based on disability, based on their need, so that they will be able to provide a much more quality support to children with disability and the family. And we are also now trying to push the government to appoint the 204 therapists. Like every block, they have set aside the resources for a part-time therapist. So either, you know, about they set around 10,000 rupees per block to appoint a part-time therapist. I think it's fairly good to begin with. So we should now push them to appoint very quickly and also use their time to support children with disability, particularly children with severe and profound disability, more intensively, so that the therapy support also can go in the hand. And we'll have to see how we can access other resources. More importantly, I would look at it, the collaboration with the health department has to increase, because, you know, all of you are aware that health department has now appointed more number of staff for, you know, who are connected with disability, particularly district mental health program. So we have roughly about 8 to 10 staff in each district. That means there's one doctor's team in the hospital, one more team at the community level. I think for children with intellectual disability, for children with autism spectrum disorder, for children with severe disability, so we need to use their time more efficiently, because part of their job is also to ensure children with disability get whatever their needs are being addressed. So these resources are also there. In addition, I look at it, you know, we have a lot of other program called NPPCD, National Program for Prevention of Childhood Deafness. So where we have speech therapists and audiologists, and currently the education system is not connected. So we are sort of listing down all those resources and sharing with them, such that there is a technical support being made available for this group of people. So this is one thing that what we are trying to look at that. So the other most important area what I look at is particularly children with you know, deafness. We have to see many children will usually benefit if we can start introduce the sign language, at least in a block, at least one or two parents or one or two, you know, BAERTs we should take and train them up. At least the basic sign language they can teach to one child and to the sibling. So the basic, you know, educational support also made available through the sibling, once if we can teach that. I think we have to start push the, you know, education team to understand the importance of having such a skill. Because otherwise, in a situation like this, the child goes and nobody knows, you know, whether the child is learning or not learning, and how to assess is a big issue. I think some of these experiment that we need to start look at it in terms of providing a sign language, particularly those children who started the schooling late because the hearing aid and all other equipment may not be of a great use to them. So only sign language would be more supportive in terms of pursuing their education. I think we have to really support the education BARTs and all others to learn that and support these children as well. And in terms of the connectivity, I don't know how many of you are aware that at the village level we have VRW, and at the village level VRWs, and we also have at the taluk level MRWs, and at the urban level we have URW, that is urban rehabilitation workers. We recently appointed almost all of them, and all of you may be aware that we also had asked their honorarium very recently, about 2-3 months ago. So they have been reasonably paid well. So this resource is also available. I think education department need to connect with this 6,500 people. So their numbers are quite large when compared to education resources what we have. We have about roughly 6,500 people who have only meant exclusively to work to support children with disability. And their part of the role is also rehabilitation education as well. I think they should be BERTs and DRCs should start training these people and use their time as well, because they're ready. So right now connectivity is not so great. I think we need to try and support how to improve that. Of course, overall, I would say that there is certainly concern, and there is we don't know the clear path as yet. But I'm sure, given the kind of understanding what we have, given the kind of resources what we have, the openness what we have, we should be able to do more and more. And we should be able to equip not just the teachers, and we equip the ecosystem. So that is the parents group, the siblings, and the most importantly, I feel during my travel across the state, I find some of the regular teachers are extremely good. We can identify some of them and use as the resource. Now we should be able to use them as a good resource, so that they will be really supportive to these kids. And most importantly, I feel we have about in almost every district two, three medical colleges. We have right now from the education perspective, very little assessments are happening, very little technical support we are accessing from them. I think we should try and use most of our BERTs to access those resources also, particularly wherever the medical college are. We have about 40 plus medical colleges who are open to support, including the two medical colleges run by ESI hospitals. Very, very large resources. Just to give you an example, in Bangalore, we have something like 60 therapists available in the ESI hospital. Most children who are going to government school, all the government workers' children, they all have ESI cards. And all these supports are definitely, make sure that the ESI will provide such support. So the critical issue right now for me is, when you're looking at the education, we're looking at convergence, we're looking at the resources listing, we're looking at actually connecting and playing a key role and key around the BRCs and BERTs, how to equip them so that our children will get whatever they need to get. So children with disability, just not only regular education like other children. No? We need to provide all other support as well, and also the enabling environment and enabling kind of support. So only that will really suffice the many needs of the children. And I'm sure given the situation, the government is also very open, and our own minister, Mrs. Shashikala Jolle, she also being a vulnerable child, and she's keen. She really wanted to support, whatever the way that could impact many children's life. And I'm here as the commissioner, and I've been constantly in touch with DDPIs and BERTs. I have all these details of all these people, and I'm very happy to share every, the 816 teachers list I have. I have the contact details. I have even including collecting the details of these children, how we can support. So all these resources, we can make it available for my office. And we want to play a very, very proactive role and supportive role to the government system, to the NGOs, to the parent group, such that children with disability will really get what they're supposed to get. I think I would stop it here. I would be more happy to listen to others and provide any kind of a clarity or any kind of questions they have, how we can support them as well. Over to you, Ravi. Thank you. Yes,
thank you, Mr. Basavaraj. Now, actually, talking about Mr. Basavaraj, the work he does, because I know, sir, because he's been so much as a part of our lives. Our lives, matlab, the persons with disabilities' lives. As a system, he's been a part of it. And he being at that position, it also encourages our sir, namagala parchira parichitaru. ಅವರ ಆ ಹುದ್ದೆ ಒಳಗೆ ಇರೋದು ನಮಗೊಂದು ಬಲ ಬಂದಂಗೆ ಆಗಿದೆ ಸರ್. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಸರ್ ಅವರು ಆಕ್ಚುಲಾಗಿ ನಿರ್ದಿಷ್ಟವಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರ ಮತ್ತೆ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಅಂಗವಿಕಲ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರ ಇದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲನೂ ಒಳಗೊಂಡು ವಿಶೇಷ ಅಗತ್ಯವುಳ್ಳ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೆ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳಿದ್ರೆ ಪರಿಹಾರ ಮಾಡಬಹುದು. ಆಮೇಲೆ ನಿರ್ದಿಷ್ಟವಾಗಿ ಅದು ಯಾವ್ಯಾವ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ಸಹಿತ ಸರ್ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಇದು ಒಂದು ನಾವು ಹೇಳಿದಂಗೆ ಪ್ರಥಮ ಹೆಜ್ಜೆ. ಆದರೆ ಇನ್ನೂ ನಾವು ಹಲವಾರು ಹೆಜ್ಜೆಗಳನ್ನು ದಾಟಬೇಕು. ಆದರೆ ನಾವು ಹೋಗುತ್ತಾ ಬಸವರಾಜ್ ಸರು ಆಮೇಲೆ ಎಸ್ ಪಿ ಡಿ ಸಾಹೇಬರು ಅವರಿರುವಂಥ ಸಹಕಾರ ನಮಗಿರಲಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳುತ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದು ತಮ್ಮ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟಿನ ಮತ್ತು ತಮ್ಮ ಅನುಭವದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಹಂಚಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದಂಥ ಬಸವರಾಜ್ ಸರ್ಗೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಅಭಿನಂದನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸ್ತಾ ನಮ್ಮ ಮುಂದಿನ ಹಂತಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗೋಣ. ಯು ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಟೆಲ್ ಎನಿಥಿಂಗ್ ಡೈನಾ?
Yeah, I just want to clearly thank Mr. Basavaraj for highlighting two important factors. One is the kind of resource that is already available in the various departments. Though the educational segment has less resources, put together the VRW, MRW segment and now the physiotherapists who've been appointed, there is enough resource to be able to cater to the 90 odd that is registered. And there are numbers that we know on the grassroots from different departments that have not been captured within this 90,000. Addressing the educational needs, I think there are enough resources for us to currently work with to help them reach out to these kids. And also the information and data that sir holds is a key information that can be utilized to plug the problem currently with the children being not left out of the educational system. That is one thing. So that's an incredible data that you hold, sir. And I think as the sector needs this kind of support and this is already available, we should be thinking of how to be utilizing this resource right now to Mr. Reju said, there are people who have already started their own in groups in terms of wanting to train CWSN and solutions at small levels at the BIERTs, the block levels. I think we should sort of do something to bring that at some point at the state level and work on empowering them. The second key thing that I really liked that sir brought to the notice was, over the 90,000 odd children, 60% of them are children who are can be in the mainstream setup. And the rest, there is a considerable amount of children whom we need to particularly address in terms of actually even enabling basic access. And there, after that segment of this 30-35 children who are multiple disabilities, MR, CPs, who are the ones who really can't be in the mainstream, the second segment that sir said was the children with hearing impairment. Even from our data, we realized that that is the next second largest segment of disabilities that we have seen. Children with hearing impairment. And the solutions for hearing impairment are already in place. There are various NGOs who work with us who already have solutions for that particular segment of children, which has been underutilized. So at the state level, it is good for us to see, instead of going ahead and reinventing all of this, to see how we can utilize these two. So I think two good takeaways that we personally hold as Nanugu Shale from sir's sharing today. We'll go to the next speakers and probably when we come through, we'll summarize the whole thing.
Okay. The next speaker is from UNICEF. The next speaker is next, please. Yes. The next speaker is from Ms. Sukanya Subramaniam. Is from she's from UNICEF. Now talking about UNICEF, I cannot say anything about UNICEF because for the last 50 years, more than 70 years, that has been the focus on children. And from the Second World War, it's been in the UN. And right now, that has been in the cross-cutting edge, specifically with children with disability and the girl child and then everything. So now UNICEF has got lots of material and experience. So we request Ms. Sukanya, madam, to come on the stage and kindly share her experience about how to address the issue of education for children with disability from an international perspective and from a specific her experience in our state, please. Thank you, Ms. Sukanya Subramaniam, please. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for having me over. Listening to both Dr. Reggie.
Is it possible for you to have your video up? Is that okay?
The thing is, my phone gives me some kind of weird problems if I have the video on.
Okay.
So please excuse me. I'll stick to the audio so it goes a bit seamlessly.
Back. Yes, ma'am.
As I was saying, after listening to both Dr. Reju, with whom I work very closely, and Mr. Basavaraj, I see how much of work the two departments are doing in order to address the issue of learning, especially for children with difficulties. They have given us excellent, the excellent strategies that they are trying to put into place, some that have already been put into place. And I think it's a good idea to support them in whatever they are doing. Because if I am going to talk, I'm not going to talk about administration or things like that, but I'm going to talk about the child's perspective and what it means for children with difficulties and what we as adults need to do for them under these extraordinary situations. As it is, by themselves, they are in a different kind of a situation. And now it takes on, huge proportions. So when we say, we say education for all. It simply means all. It means there are no exceptions. We cannot afford to have exceptions. So well, then comes the next question. How to put in for the most vulnerable children in areas and times of school closures? Normal times itself, it is a challenge. But what do we do during such times? I could give you some kind of a checklist of factors which we need to consider when we are planning our COVID-19 education. You see, this outbreak led to hundreds of millions of children in countries and territories worldwide who are affected by school closures, which actually has been aimed at slowing the transmission of the pandemic. But this number could grow as more countries take decisions to contain the virus or open up the lockdown, since the world cannot be kept in a lockdown mode indefinitely. All the more reason why we need to be on our toes now. To ensure continuity of children's learning, all governments, as we are saying, across the globe and in our own country, are devising plans that can be implemented in various contexts. They are trying to find alternative means for children to continue learning during this period. Various remote learning options are being considered. Some have already been activated, including delivering education through online teaching, digital access to learning materials, teaching through radio, television, distribution of printed material, among other options. While all these efforts aim at ensuring that learning is not disrupted, and it also aims to mitigate against the negative effects that are associated with prolonged periods of school closures. You know, lessons from West Africa, where the Ebola outbreak, it led to unprecedented negative effects on children because of school closures. you know, and that provides a strong basis, which makes it necessary for us to understand that we have to continue learning at all costs. When it comes to children, coping with the unknown, navigating school closures, abrupt changes in routines, loss of connections with teachers and friends, fear around contracting the virus because they, you know, reflect whatever the adults are talking about, that is there in their minds, they may not talk about it. All these, and you know, these are all burdens for children. And caregivers at this point play a very important role in helping children and young adults understand the changes and to process the feelings that are related to these changes. Now, individuals with autism may need extra support to process the news and adapt to the many changes that are happening around us. There are various situations that we need to keep in mind. While remote learning strategies aim to ensure continued learning for all children, we know that the most marginalized children, including those with disabilities, there are struggling learners, children with ethnic minorities, children on the move. We are talking about migrant, refugee, internally displaced children, children in the most rural, hard to reach, and the poorest communities, more so girls who are tasked with caring for ill family members. They may not be able to access these opportunities. Vulnerabilities may also expand the shift or multiply during health emergencies. For example, girls may be more susceptible to gender-based violence and be more isolated as their school peer support network shrinks. This may be due to lack of access to the internet or failure to afford the required equipment, or simply because the modality of delivery may not meet their needs. At the same time, in the poorest households where caregivers or parents may have low educational attainment, where they have never experienced distance schooling or themselves have disabilities, they may struggle to support their children's learning. Globally, data shows that the poorest and the most marginalized children are missing out on schooling or fare poorly in learning outcomes compared to their counterparts. I mean, this is not something I have to tell you now, but this is something we all know, and we all have the data with us to know what it actually means. And in emergencies, the situation simply becomes compounded. You know, while echoing the leading principle of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development to leave no one behind, and SDG 4, which aims to ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all, it is important to ensure that no child is left behind during this period. It is imperative that strategies to support continued learning for children take into consideration the needs of the poorest and the most marginalized children. This will ensure that all children benefit and are able to continue with their learning while the departments are doing their utmost best. Some of these points that I'm raising, if kept in mind, they will be able to, you know, what happens normally when one is administering? I have been that also. I've played that role of an administrator at one point in my life, and I know what we think of is we have a larger picture in our mind and we look at, you know, overall general everything. But when it comes to children with difficulties, children with I don't mean only the children with disabilities, but children who are in difficult circumstances, we need to view our strategies with a slightly more tuned in lens, and that will help us to get strategies. There is no dearth of thinking minds in any department. And I'm sure when they put their minds together and you have officers like Mr. Basavaraj or Mr. Reju or anybody out there who's leading these departments, the best solutions for these people, these children will also come forth. It is also apparent that with remote education, the poor and marginalized learners will require special support to access and process the content to maximize their learning. Only that will allow them to stay at par with their peers. It is important to assess all significant bottlenecks and barriers that mitigate against reaching vulnerable and marginalized children during school closures. you know, this thought in head while planning will help the departments. In response, pragmatic interventions most explicitly seek to mitigate these barriers. It is important to also monitor whether children from vulnerable groups manage to continue with learning and to what intensity. This will help shape the mitigation strategies that must be put in place to ensure these children are able to catch up when they return to school. So, you know, we cannot have a one size fits all. Even when Dr. Reggie was talking about the curtailing the curriculum and, you know, having, when we take those measures, we will need to have it kind of tailor-made to the different needs of children. It means a lot of work for the teachers and for the department, but then it is a lifelong thing and it will always come in handy if in other emergencies as well. While some of the points that I'm bringing up may not be exhaustive, they can definitely be used as a kind of a checklist to ensure that opportunities for remote learning work for the poorest and the most vulnerable children. I'm simply using the word vulnerable children because, I mean, it encompasses within itself children with disabilities and other deprivations. One is provision of learning devices or equipment and connectivity. I know there will be a lot of discussion on this, but this is also possible for those who can access it. Where remote learning strategies include the provision of learning equipment, something like tablets, radios, printed material, it is also important to ensure that consideration is made to cover the needs of children who may require specialized equipment to support their learning, including sensitive technology and devices for children with disabilities. We are talking very generically about the radio, TV, etc. But what kind of support are we going to give to children who need specialized devices? It is necessary to consider disparities, which is increased by the digital divide, and to ensure, where feasible, that adequate internet access is provided in rural areas, which means, like Mr. Basavaraj said, a coming together of various departments. It's not just the education or one or two or health or something, but it is the coming together of several departments. For example, radio instruction is a good alternative when schools are closed and when children may not have access to the internet or e-learning devices. Also, online safety tips are encouraged, especially considering the children and families which are less familiar to technology or connectivity, as they may become more vulnerable to bullying, online scams, exploitation, including but not limited to online sexual exploitation or grooming that leads to other forms of sexual abuse. We have to be sensitive to these things which are already happening. The second point is accessibility of instruction. All children must access learning regardless of the medium of delivery. And for children with disabilities, this includes closed captions, live sign language interpretation, large print, visual or audio adaptations of material, etc. Planning of strategies for continued learning during this period must align with universal design for learning to benefit all children. Then we come to, you know, the language of instruction. Without advanced planning, there may be difficulties in adapting a curriculum to a diverse set of mother tongues. However, for remote learning, if remote learning has to be relevant and it has to allow a broad participation, mother tongue language provision should be prioritized and implemented wherever possible. This could also include the use of a combination of sign language, subtitles, visual cues, etc., where education is delivered through television. Then we come to individualized education plans. It might sound very ambitious, but it is necessary and we have to think about this. Wherever feasible and appropriate, children simply should have individualized education plans that identify their specific needs, goals, adaptations, and the kind of support that is required to help child remain on track. It's necessary for the child to stay on track and not fall somewhere by the wayside because we were not able to give them the tools required for them to stay abreast of their peers. As such, it is important to develop plans collaboratively with caregivers, parents, regarding the services before and during a closure, including contingency plans or any prolonged future disruptions and things like that. Then when we come to the caregivers or parental engagement, remote learning invariably requires a commitment to attend classes or keep track of learning modules and timetables. Children with disabilities may need support with attending and participating. The reality is that some caregivers may not be in the position to support learning if they are not available due to work or have not completed that level of schooling or are not literate in the language of instruction themselves. And or they may have be experiencing some form of disability. It is important that these people are supported with resources and sensitized on how they can support their children's learning during this time, such as establishment of a caregiver parent support network or something like that, which will facilitate support. I recall Dr. Basavaraj talking about a lot of people out in the field, teachers, to get teachers involved, Mr. Reju talking about so many other people who are there on the field. How is it that we get them all to provide this kind of a support network is something we should all think about. Then we have to have a structure and a routine. While the school provides a structure and a routine for learning, home learning does not do that, and therefore can be challenging for children with disabilities. Especially children with difficulties do much better when they have a routine. They respond much better. As do other children, as we have seen in the various emergencies across the globe. That is the reason why we have what is called the school in a box. So in an emergency situation, any kind of emergency, UNICEF will invariably, after the health and the water sections have gone into the field to provide the first level of response to those who are affected, the third sector which goes into the area or into the battlefield is the education thing, which goes in there with what is called the school in a box, because children require a routine to normalize and to adjust to the trauma that they are experiencing. So sensitizing caregivers, parents, and teachers setting up a structure or a routine is very critical to ensure that children's learning is prioritized. Then we come to a very important part, which is the psychosocial support, protection and prevention, management of gender-based violence. We are already seeing examples right now. Schools provide a social environment where children interact and play with their peers. For many children with disabilities, peer relations, social perceptions, social competence are significant aspects. Being confined at home could have psychosocial impacts. As such, special efforts will require to be made to provide this kind of psychosocial support. And there are different modalities of how this could be done. One needs to examine those. In some cases, additional safety risks, especially for those who are vulnerable and or those who live in households where intimate partner violence or child abuses are. Further, girls may face increased protection risks, such as increased violence, sexual exploitation, teen pregnancy, etc. Protection specialists should be engaged and consulted to offer solutions and support on how best these risks and safeguarding can happen. Often schools have referral mechanisms, but in times of school closures, this line of communication is broken. And therefore, it's very important to work with protection and health specialists to disseminate appropriate information, sharing of protocols, and referral pathways. We come to then the protection and inclusion of children on the move. Migrant, refugee, displaced children are already disproportionately affected by learning disruptions, and they make up a large part of the out-of-school child population. Children on the move are at a heightened risk. They often live in cramped conditions with limited access to water, and the need to be reached with accurate information in a language they understand. Children of labor migrants often live in the most disadvantaged urban areas where access to essential services is already limited. Children on the move may depend on school lunches and other school for non-informal learning space services. As learning spaces close down, we have to consider how to provide not only alternative learning, but also alternative safe options for hot meals and other vital support for these vulnerable little ones. Further, the misinformation on the spread of COVID-19 actually increases and the discrimination that migrant and displaced children and their families already face. Growing stigmatization of groups and ethnicities associated with the disease is deeply concerning. And here at UNICEF, we are working very hard to see that, there is no stigma attached to getting this ailment. Then we come to communication, sensitization, media campaigns on the value of girls' education. All programs must be designed with a gender lens and should be inclusive and accessible to girls with disabilities. I will not linger longer on that particular point. We are looking at learning beyond the school curricula. I think Dr. Reju already mentioned that the lessons on TV may not necessarily be what is there in the curriculum, but it will teach them various other things. For example, children may learn more about their caregivers, their parents' skills and trade, or in communities not in lockdown, community members, teachers can teach some skills to small groups of children while following social distancing norms. Then we have what in UNICEF we say, build back better. Recognizing that many vulnerable children may not be accessing quality and inclusive learning opportunities pre-COVID-19, resumption of schooling presents an opportunity now to build back better. Let us look at the opportunity this COVID-19 is bringing to us. That is looking at the positive side of things. Let us capitalize on the strategies and resources that are being put in place during this crisis so that we can increase access and improve learning opportunities for all children. This includes ensuring that learning spaces are accessible to those experiencing physical disabilities, that all children, and particularly girls, can access school safely, that there are gender-segregated latrines and bathrooms to encourage girls' attendance, that schools are equipped for children experiencing learning impairments, that teachers are prepared to teach students of all abilities, and that communities and caregivers are actively engaged and participate in the local education system and are well informed of how to support their children. There are exactly 7 strategies that are designed to meet the unique needs of individuals during this period of uncertainty. Very briefly, I will not go into details. These are 1, support understanding. 2, offer opportunities for expression. 3, prioritize coping and calming skills. 4, maintain routines. 5, build new routines. 6, foster connections from a distance. And 7, be aware of changing behavior. I think I have kind of put what I needed to say into this. I think that's all from me. If there are any questions or something, maybe I'll take it later or I'm open to it. Over. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kwenya. Thank you for a very detailed presentation. Actually, you have given us an encyclopedia, not really because the vastness of your presentation, we need it in writing, madam. That is because Sukanya madam avaru sudhirghavagi ivattu vishesha kalutulla makkalige ashte alla makkalige ivattu ಏನೇನು ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದಲ್ಲಿ ಅದು ಈ ಕೋವಿಡ್ ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆ ಒಳಗೆ ಏನೇನು ಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ಸುದೀರ್ಘವಾಗಿ ಒಂದು ವ್ಯಾಖ್ಯಾನ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ಅವ್ರು ಮೇಡಮ್ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಹೇಳೇನಿ, ಇದು ಮಾತಾಡಿದ್ರಷ್ಟೇ ಸಾಲದು ಮೇಡಮ್, ಇದು ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯದೊಳಗಾಗಬೇಕು, ತಮ್ಮ ಸಹಕಾರ ಬೇಕು, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಲಿಖಿತವಾಗಿ ಬೇಕು, ಅದು ಅದಾದ್ರೆ ಬಹಳ ಉತ್ತಮ ಆಗತ್ತೆ.
I will send it to you. I will send you a write-up on that. Sure.
Please. Thank you, madam. Thank you very much. So, adike ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ವಿಶ್ವಸಂಸ್ಥೆ ಯುನಿಸೆಫ್ ಅವರು ಸುಮಾರು ವರ್ಷಗಳಿಂದ ವಿಶೇಷ ಅಗತ್ಯ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೂ ಏನದು ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಾಚರಣೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಆ ಯುನಿಸೆಫಿನ ಫ್ರೇಮ್ವರ್ಕ್ ಚೌಕಟ್ಟಿನೊಳಗೆ ಅಂತಾರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ಮಟ್ಟದೊಳಗೆ ಮತ್ತು ಇವತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದೊಳಗೆ ಏನಾಗಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಒಂದು ಸುದೀರ್ಘವಾಗಿ ಒಂದು ವ್ಯಾಖ್ಯಾನ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಮೇಡಮ್ ಅವರು. ಇದನ್ನು ನಾವು ಮುಂದುವರಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗಬೇಕು. ಅದು ಅದು ವಿಶೇಷ ಅಗತ್ಯ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಆಯಿತು, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಬಡ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಆಯಿತು, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೂ ಅಂತಾರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ಮಟ್ಟದೊಳಗೆ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ನಡೀತಾ ಇದ್ದಾವೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ಚಿತ್ರಣ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇನ್ನು ನಾವು ಅನುಷ್ಠಾನಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಮುಂದಾಗಬೇಕು. ಸೊ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಸುಕನ್ಯಾ ಮೇಡಮ್ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು. ಯು ವಾಂಟ್ ಆಡ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಡಯಾನಾ?
Nothing. I think we should take some points in the Q&A. I'm sure they will come. Thank you, yeah. Sukanya ma'am. We'll go to the next part in view of time as well.
Yeah, yeah. Mundina bhashanakaru Dr. Niranjan Aradhya. Niranjan avaru namage baala ondu chira parichitaru namma. Avaru naavu yakantara ondu santike tagolona. ಅವರು ನಾವು ಒಂದು ಕಾಲದೊಳಗೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೂ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಮೂಲಭೂತ ಹಕ್ಕಾಗಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ 80ರಿಂದ ಅವರಾಯಿತು, ಅವರ ಮಿಸ್ಸಸ್ ಆಯಿತು, ಅವಾಗಲಿಂದ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಮೂಲಭೂತ ಹಕ್ಕಾಗಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ನಾವು ಘೋಷಣೆ ಇಟ್ಟುಕೊಂಡು ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಚಳವಳಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ವಿ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಆದರೆ ಈಗ ಅವರು ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಲಾ ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಲೈಸೇಷನ್ ಈಗ ಒಂದು ಅದು ಮೂಲಭೂತ ಹಕ್ಕಾಗಿದೆ ಕರೆ, ಆದರೆ ಅದು ಅನುಷ್ಠಾನ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಫ್ರೇಮ್ವರ್ಕ್ ಚೌಕಟ್ಟು ಆ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರದೊಳಗೆ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ನಿರಂಜನ್ ಅವರು. ಅವರಿಗೆ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಅಪರಿಚಿತರಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ಶಿಕ್ಷಕರು ಯಾರು ಇಲ್ಲ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಎಸ್ ಎಂ ಸಿ ಅವರು ಯಾರು ಇಲ್ಲ, ಅವರೇ ಬಂದು ನಮ್ಗಿಂತಲೂ ಅವರೇ ಬಂದು ಮಾತಾಡಲಿ ಈಗ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೀನಿ, ಕೇಳ್ಕೊತೀನಿ. ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ನಿರಂಜನ್ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.
ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ, ಗುಡ್ ಮಾರ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಆಲ್. ರವಿ, ನಿಮ್ಮ ಎಲ್ಲ ಪ್ರೀತಿಯ ಮಾತುಗಳಿಗೆ ನಾನು ಆಭಾರಿಯಾಗಿದ್ದೇನೆ. ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ಮೆನಿ ಕೋ ಪ್ಯಾನಲಿಸ್ ಐ ಪ್ರಾಬಬಲಿ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಬೋತ್ ಯು ನೋ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಕನ್ನಡ ಆಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಆಸ್ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್. ಐ ಕುಡ್ ಸಿ ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಯು ನೋ ಕನ್ನಡ ಸ್ಪೀಕಿಂಗ್ ಯು ನೋ community with us. I think, you know, like many issues have already been flagged, and please excuse me for maybe certain you know kind of overlaps and repetitions, you know, to please bear with me. I know to begin with, certainly I congratulate Ravi, Diana and his team for organizing this webinar, at least to discuss and debate issues pertaining to children with disabilities, and particularly looking at the broader, you know, aspects of school education. I have already listened to three important speakers. I think probably they have raised very important issues, particularly Dr. Reju raised issues about the preparations that the Karnataka government is making basically to address this unprecedented challenging situation. I'm fully endorsed, you know, like, and also appreciate the preparations made by the education department, keeping teachers at the center. I think it's really an important move. Similarly, Mr. Rajanna raised very important issues about the convergence, and that is also very important because particularly when we come to issues related to children with disabilities, certainly we need larger convergence, you know, kind of helping each other, because it is not just education, it is also issues related to health, you know, all other support systems like that. Of course, Sukanya raised very important issues in terms of keeping the child at the center, which is very, very important based on rich experience working especially with children under UNICEF. Friends, to begin with, I just want to demystify one important aspect. Prarambhadal nanu ondu amshavanna tamge rupislikke bahala ishta padtene. Just to demystify, let us not presume that pre-COVID namanna avarsodkinta munche ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲವೂ ಸರಿ ಇತ್ತು, ಎಲ್ಲವೂ ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಸಿಗ್ತಾ ಇತ್ತು. ವಿಶೇಷವಾಗಿ ಯಾರು ಚಿಲ್ಡ್ರನ್ ವಿತ್ ಡಿಸಬಿಲಿಟೀಸ್ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆಲ್ಲವೂ ಸಿಗ್ತಿತ್ತು ಅಂತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಒಂದು ನಂಬಿಕೆ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಇವತ್ತು ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಅದು ಏನು ಇವತ್ತು ಪೋಸ್ಟ್ ಕೋವಿಡ್, ಕೋವಿಡ್ನ ನಂತರ ಅದೆಲ್ಲವೂ ಸಂಪೂರ್ಣವಾಗಿ ಅಸ್ತವ್ಯಸ್ತ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಅದನ್ನ ಹೇಗೆ ಪುನರ್ ಸಂಘಟಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದು ಅನ್ನೋ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಚರ್ಚೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದೀವಿ. ಲೆಟ್ ಅಸ್ ಟ್ರೈ ಟು ಅಂಡರ್ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ರೆಕಗ್ನೈಸ್ ಈವನ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ಪ್ರೀ ಕೋವಿಡ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ವರ್ ನಾಟ್ ಅಪ್ ಟು ದ ಮಾರ್ಕ್. ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ಲಿ ವೆನ್ ಐ ಸೇ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದಿ ಇಂಪ್ಲಿಮೆಂಟೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ರೈಟ್ ಟು ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್, ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಸ್ ನೋ ದಟ್ ದ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೈನ್ಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಅರೌಂಡ್ 11-12%. ಅಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಸ್ ನೋ ದಿ ಸೀರಿಯಸ್ ಲಿಮಿಟೇಷನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ರೈಟ್ ಟು ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್. ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಲ್, ದ ರೈಟ್ ಟು ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಅಲೈನ್ಡ್ ವಿತ್ ದಿ new development in the sector, particularly the new legislations that persons with disability act 2016. My only kind of concern is, even before things were not as all of us expected, let us recognize this truth, and let us recognize these as an opportunity now, to put things, to institutionalize things in a much more meaningful manner, particularly to address the issue of right to education for all children, with a special focus children with special needs and disabilities.
Sorry, Niranjan sir, can you speak a little louder? I think many of them are not able to hear you.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
If now, you can just hold the mic to... Sorry.
So yeah. With these, understanding, let me, tell about 4 to 5 important points, and may not be, good to have a very detailed presentations, because friends have already, addressed many issues. The most important thing is, this particular situation is unexpected. All of us, or whether the state or the central government, none of us were expecting this kind of a situation, an unprecedented crisis, we were also not prepared, and even today we are not prepared to address this a crisis. And second important thing is, it affected all aspects of human life. When I say human, it includes all children also. It affected health, livelihood, education, safety, protection, not only in Karnataka or in India, across the globe. All of us know that there are roughly about 1.57 billion children affected by these, roughly about 157 crores and 199 countries across the globe. So therefore, the challenge is how constructively we engage, both constructively and critically engage with the state to get right things for children, particularly children with disabilities, children with special needs. I think that is an important question that we need to address in this webinar. Of course, the bigger challenge is, the bigger challenge at this during this crisis is to save, strengthen, and transform each public school into a genuine neighborhood school for inclusive education. Let me reiterate, even more or less we are talking the language of integration. I think it is necessary that we need to switch over to the inclusive language. So basically, how do we transform each government school into a kind of a genuine neighborhood school? And this is very important in the COVID times, because both in terms of physical distance, both in terms of transportation, these things becomes very, very important. So therefore, just to conclude, you know, to raise an important issue, it's very challenging for all of us, government, policymakers, teachers, teachers union, civil society organizations, and community-based organization. I consider all of them as, you know, kind of at this juncture as change makers at the ground level, you know, like particularly to make proactive interventions, you know, to protect and promote the rights of children with special focus on children with disability. So therefore, I personally feel all of us need a very holistic approach to address these issues. One is certainly education is one part of it, but we have much more larger issues. So therefore, I think we need a very holistic approach to address this unprecedented you know, kind of crisis. I think we have to understand this particular, you know, kind of aspect. What do I mean when I say holistic? This already I've expressed this in many forums. When I say holistic, I think this is many speakers have already, you know, kind of raised this issue. Let us use this, you know, opportunity, to really bring the kind of changes that what we were expecting from last 50 to 70 years. So for me, the first, you know, kind of understanding of this holistic approach is based on our understanding of rights-based approach. Rights-based approach should be the, you know, kind of one of the main pillar for all of us. I think probably we need to address this issue of children with disability also from the rights-based approach. All of us know that whenever there is a crisis, whether it is natural disaster, man-made, or, you know, a crisis like that we are passing through, the most, you know, affected community is vulnerable, you know, people. And of course, children are always vulnerable to such conditions. So therefore, rights of those people, rights of children become jeopardized, you know, whether it is right to education, right to food, or, you know, our main legislation of rights of persons with a disability act, which has been reviewed in 2016. So therefore, this is a new legislation. So therefore, rights approach should be the center. It's not just charity. It's not like the language that we were using last 40, 50 years. I think there is a need, there is an urgent need to change. And certainly we have to recognize, when I talk about rights approach, we need to recognize the international human rights normative framework and principles. And certainly we have to uphold the UNCRC and also UNCRPD. That is important, you know, kind of a normative framework for us, along with the Constitution, the core values of the Constitution in terms of social justice. We ensure, and also we have agreed to ensure equitable quality education to all children by 2030. So therefore, friends, for me, this particular framework, rights-based framework, is very, very important. And certainly we need to ensure whether this is a framework that all our discussions at the department level, at various other places, at the ground level, whether we are really following this kind of a framework is an important issue for me when I talk about children with vulnerability, particularly children with a disability. So this is the first point that I just want to raise. Like, all of us need to ask how you know, kind of important all our interventions, and how all these interventions are really based on the rights approach as a basic entitlement, is an issue that we need to really think over. The second most important, I'm always, you know, kind of, let us move away from this integrated approach to include, you know, kind of all inclusive approach. I think that is very important. And even within children, if you look at the number of categories, the children with disabilities, when I talk, the children who need a minimal support, which these children who need maximum support, the children who need some, you know, kind of extraordinary support, you know, because we have all three different, you know, categories of children defined in the legislation. So therefore, how do we really make it all inclusive? And within, again, all inclusives, there are children, you know, kind of from marginalized communities who are more vulnerable and also disadvantaged groups, and particularly girl children, migrant children, and children, you know, from tribe. All these issues becomes, you know, very important for us. Then how do we really locate, and what kind of plans that we prepare for these children to really make our interventions, you know, all inclusive, and also taking everyone together becomes a very important and a very important second aspect for me, because certainly we need to go beyond like what we are not able to achieve in the last 40-50 years. So therefore, this inclusiveness is the core, you know, kind of principle where that each one of us need to adopt. So ella maklana adrali ola madkoltakkantadu ondu baala mukhyavadanta amsha agutte hagagi adanna naviga udaharanege reju avaru maatadtiddaga helidru naavu plan ana maartideve anta. So aa plan alli kandita naavu ella maklana serisukota ideva. Otherwise, you know, like take for example a simple provision under the Right to Education Act. Section 9 of the Right to Education Act talks about identifying all children at the grassroots level, at the village level. I tell you honestly, so far, we're not able to keep a complete register of all children at the village level or the panchayat level. So therefore, the question of inclusiveness becomes still, you know, kind of a kind of a fundamental question. If you are not able to know the number of children, and if you are not able to identify all children, then the question of inclusiveness remains, you know, kind of unanswered. So therefore, I think probably we need to, you know, kind of take this as the second important aspect. The third most important aspect, of course, this is particularly focused on the present situation. All of us are talking about, you know, kind of reopening of schools and what kind of, you know, interventions that we need to, you know, start to address the crisis that what we are going through. I personally feel there is no one single kind of interventions. There should be multiple interventions to address this, because the needs are multiple. There are multiple needs within the you know, kind of disabled community, but also within the larger, you know, kind of community within the children. So therefore, I think our intervention should be multiple. I think given, you know, the composition of children attending government schools, because majority of them are from the marginalized community, from disadvantaged sections. And what is important for us to understand that the livelihood aspect of these communities have been completely, you know, kind of destroyed, in the sense they are now struggling basically to earn their, you know, kind of day-to-day livelihood. So therefore, when we talk about children attending the government school, for me, I think nutrition, the midday meal, becomes very, very important for children at this particular point of time. I think probably we cannot serve the midday meal like what we did in the past. I think it needs a lot of improvement. And look at, you know, the Odisha government has already increased the per child cost, you know, both for lower primary and higher primary. I think probably we need to learn some of these things from other states also. So nutrition becomes the topmost thing for me, because at least these children should get hot cooked day meal. So therefore, that is also a reason why I am also arguing for opening of schools with all safety is an urgent need, because otherwise it may push children for, you know, kind of more problems in terms of child labor, child marriage, you know, things like that. So therefore, our priorities also need to be, you know, located in these context. Of course, safety and security is another important measure need to be considered during this time. And also, like when you talk about safety and security, we're also talking about the infrastructure. Our friends, particularly when we talk about infrastructure, the schedule attached to Right to Education Act talks about, the kind of landscape of the building, the facilities available and all. And all of us know that even today in Karnataka, nearly about 40 to 45% of the schools have no ramps. I'm just talking only with reference to one basic infrastructure facilities. I'm not talking about learning aids. I'm not talking about enabling learning environment. I'm not talking about all trained teachers. I think, this inclusiveness cannot be compartmentalized. We can't say that there are only, so many people who are responsible for inclusive education. That becomes a very compartmental approach. I think we need to have a more inclusive approach, and we need to, sensitize and train all teachers. How do we really address the issues of children with disabilities? So therefore, I think all these issues, safety, security, infrastructure, teaching learning material, all this becomes very, very important when we talk about the right to education of these children. Of course, as all of us know, that children are almost vulnerable, more vulnerable to these kind of health crises. So therefore, even a kind of a random check or a kind of a arrangement for mobile clinics to have random check in selected places to ensure that, it is not really, kind of spreading among the children community. We need to ensure, we need to ensure and check that time and again. So therefore, what kind of arrangements that at least, we are doing, at least some kind of an arrangement is also an issue that we need to address. Of course, education is an important component, but what I personally feel, Right to Education Act was enacted in 2009, and Rights of Persons with Disability Act was enacted in 2016. I think the most important thing for us now to align right to education with the new legislation. I think so far we have not done, because if you look at some of the definitions, even in 2009, when the right to education was enacted and which came into force in 2010, things were not up to the mark as long as children with disability is concerned. There was again another movement which resulted in amendment to the act in 2012. So the first legislation, the earlier legislation, was not really encompassed the issues related to these communities. So therefore, how do we align Right to Education Act along with the new legislations, because there is a separate chapter which address the aspects of education, how to do that, and how do we really provide what kind of supports for the minimal needs and the those who need maximum support, those who need much more support. All these things are in a way detailed further. So therefore, I think we need to align this particular legislation with the Right to Education Act. I think that should be the first priority. We need to prepare a blueprint, aligning those aspects. And based on that, I think we need to prepare a new action plan. Why this becomes very important? Unless we think, think of multiple ways of addressing these issues, again, we may get lost. Particularly when we talk about children with disability. And of course, the entire process of addressing these issues along with other children is also a collaborative exercise. When I say collaborative, more collaborative at the ground level, more convergent at the higher level, convergence in terms of line departments and all that is at the higher level to send the right message, and more collaborative at the school level. Particularly, I just want to bring in the school development and monitoring committees. If you look at the scheme of implementing the legislation, particularly the right to education, three important actors are there to implement: the state and the central government, which is the appropriate government, local authority, that is the panchayat and nagarapalike, town, municipal corporations, and of course third most important is the school development and monitoring committee. Of course, in fact, Reju was raising the issue of micro planning. I think this is very important at this point of time. How do we prepare our school development plan, which is a mandatory provision under the Right to Education Act under section 22, and SDMCs are given the complete responsibility of preparing the plan. And many people have already raised, you know, the kind of elements that we need to include. Probably all those elements need to reflect in the school development plan. I think that becomes very, very important. So school development and monitoring committees, Anganwadi workers, midday meal workers, ASHA workers, and of course the parents are the very crucial players in this entire process. So therefore, how do we collaborate with them? How do we collaborate with the local self-government, which is responsible for providing the basic infrastructure and also support system under section 9 is an issue that we need to understand. And also, sorry to raise this, how many of them are really aware about these legislations? How many of them are aware about the Right to Education Act? How many of them are aware about the rights of, you know, Persons with Disability Act, which is the latest legislation in 2016? I think probably sensitizing them is very, very important. So therefore, I join with Dr. Reju. Sensitizing children, teachers is very, very important. And also to that list, I add sensitizing the members of the panchayat, particularly the PDOs and all other primary stakeholders, is also equally important, because I think probably they need to understand and locate this issue in the larger socio-cultural context. You know, like, I think that becomes very, very important. Of course, the community-based organizations, youth, students, or self-help groups, or, you know, various other groups who can play a very important role in the entire process, becomes also very important. And how do we, you know, kind of rope in them into this entire process? Of course, civil society organization and NGOs have been doing their part. But I just want to add one, you know, kind of cursor here, basically to tell that all our efforts is to supplement the state, not to substitute the state. This I have been telling more or less from last three decades. And the state is the primary, primary obligation to provide and to realize these rights. So therefore, all of us, our efforts, how best we can supplement the state, is also an important understanding, and we need to orient them. We need to, I don't say educate, at least make them aware what really rights we mean, and what really rights when we talk about vulnerable community like children with disability, you know, things like that. And the last thing that I just want to flag, and, you know, just to conclude before we go for question and answers, I think this unprecedented crisis expects, you know, kind of a joint responsibility for both the state, center, as well as the local authority. For me, the most important thing is the resources. I think unless we spend resources, unless we spend, you know, kind of considerable amount of finance on this issue, we may not be able to, you know, really move forward. So therefore, I personally feel there is a need for us to ask a special package to address this unprecedented crisis. And this special package should come to all states. And each state can plan and use these financial resources according to the challenges. You know, take, for example, Reju mentioned about the small schools. Certainly, in small school, physical distance is not a big issue, because hardly we have children, you know, 10, 15, 20 children, and we have enough classrooms. So therefore, it varies from school to school, block to block, cluster to cluster, district to district. So therefore, I think we need to understand, and to address this, we need resources, and these resources should reach school. I strongly advocate that at least the special package, we must be able to give some substantial amount to our school development and monitoring committee. At least our school grant at the lower primary should be enhanced to 1 lakh in case of lower primary and 1.5 or 2 lakhs in case of higher primary, because Dr. Reju was, you know, kind of mentioning, this micro planning combined with the school development plan, it helps, you know, SDMCs to design concrete, you know, kind of interventions according to their local requirements and local needs, in a much more decentralized, manner. So therefore, this special package is very, very important. Third most important point, I think all of you agree with me, we have been, at least myself, along with the school development and monitoring committees, we have been raising this issue of strengthen and transform each government school into a neighborhood school for a long period. I think this is the right time. This is the right time to do that. What is the lessons that we have learned from the COVID? The lessons that what we have learned from the COVID, the issue was well addressed with commitment from the people who are there in the public sector. Whether this is the doctors, nurses, ASHA workers, Anganwadi workers, I think, you know, like building a strong state-funded health and education system is a kind of a necessity to address any kind of challenges, any disaster, whether it is natural or man-made, whatever it is. I think this is the lessons that what we have learned from the COVID. Strengthening our public education, strengthening our, health system, strengthening our primary health centers at the village level becomes very, very important in terms of both providing education for these children and also providing the, health in terms of referral services, in terms of, whatever their, health needs. So that becomes very, very important. I think probably we need to engage with the state on these issues. How do we engage with the state both constructively and critically to raise these issues and also to address, the manners of privatization and commercialization of education? Of course, Dr. Reju clarified a couple of things on online education. Let us understand the very purpose of education is socialization. The very purpose of education is preparing children for good citizenship. The very purpose of education is to uphold the constitutional values. So online education cannot substitute all these things. That may be, temporary intervention because of the crisis, but it is not neither a substitute or alternate to the schooling system. So therefore, opening schools, providing that kind of a safe and secure place, providing good day meal, extending the health facility, designing some activities, to help children to overcome the kind of anxiety and fear that they have. And moreover, educating all children about these unprecedented crises, particularly educating them in their own language, in their own perspective. Because all these days, nearly for about two and a half months, 90 days, the language that what we are, talking is more, adult centered. We are educating more, adults on these issues, and we have not really done much on, things. Of course, I read one of the booklet shared by Diana, which was really, commendable work. I think we need to multiply such, exercise, help children to understand. Then they can better, cope up with the situation and also respond well. So therefore, I think, probably we need to keep this larger framework, implement the core legislations like right to education and rights of persons with disability to do justice for children, particularly the children with disabilities. So I think that I can stop here. And this is basically the things that I thought I could share. Because whenever I talk with Ravi, I always raise the issue of education of children with disability as part and parcel of the larger kind of an issue. This is an inclusive question because all of us know that many times we heard, all of us are one way or the other, have one or the other kind of disability. So let us not, you know, kind of compartmentalize, disaggregate. So I think we need to look at it from a social inclusion perspective, rights-based perspective, multiple interventions, and collaborative exercise. Thank you very much for this opportunity. I'm sure this will really, you know, kind of figure, you know, kind of at least a couple of issues, if not all. And this becomes part and parcel when Education Department or the Disability Commission plan concrete interventions to uphold the rights of these children. Thank you very much. I stop here. Over to Ravi.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Niranjan. Thank you for a very detailed explanation. Dr. Niranjan avaru samudaya andre SDMCs hagu shikshana vyavasthe ಸಮುದಾಯ ಭಾಗ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಇರಬೇಕು ಅದು ಒಂದು. ಆಮೇಲೆ ನಿಯಮಗಳು, ಎಲ್ಲ ಹಲವಾರು ನಿಯಮಗಳಿದ್ದಾವೆ, ಅದು ರೈಟ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ನಿಯಮ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಅಥವಾ ಅಂಗವಿಕಲ ಮಕ್ಕಳ ನಿಯಮ ಇರ್ಬೋದು. ಸೊ ಆ ಒಳಗೊಂಡಂತೆ ಆ ಹಲವಾರು ನಿಯಮಗಳನ್ನು ಒಂದು ಚೌಕಟ್ಟಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಇಟ್ಟುಕೊಂಡು ಹಲೋ ಕೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಾ?
ಎಸ್ ಎಸ್, ಯುವರ್ ಆಡಿಬಲ್.
ಓಕೆ. ಯಾ, ಸೊ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಎಲ್ರಿಗೂ ಸಮಾನಾಗಿರುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಫ್ರೇಮ್ ವರ್ಕ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಯಾವ ನಿಯಮಗಳದಾವೆ, ಈ ಸಂವಿಧಾನ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದೆ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ನಮ್ದು ಆ ಸೆಂಟ್ರಲ್ ಗವರ್ಮೆಂಟಿಂದ ಲೋಕಲ್ ಆಗಿ SDMCs ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಾನಿಟರಿಂಗ್ ಕಮಿಟಿ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಇದ್ರೊಳಗೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸಮುದಾಯದೊಳಗೆ ಅವಿಭಿದ ಅಂಗವಾಗಿ ಒಂದು ವಿಕಲಚೇತನ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಇರಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಒಂದು ಸುದೀರ್ಘವಾಗಿ ಚರ್ಚೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು. ಈಗ ನಾನು ಫೋರ್ತ್ ವೇ ಫೌಂಡೇಶನ್ ಅವರ ಮುಖ್ಯಸ್ಥರಾಗಿರುವಂಥ ಡೈನಾ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಅವ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಸ್ವಾಗತ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಫೋರ್ತ್ ವೇ ಫೌಂಡೇಶನ್ ನಾನು ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀನಿ. ನಾವು ಡೈನಾ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಅವರು ಸುಮಾರು ವರ್ಷಗಳಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮ ಪರಿಚಯ. ಆದರೆ ಯಾವಾಗ ಒಂದು ನಾವು ಒಮ್ಮೆ ತೀರ್ಮಾನ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ, ಅಂಗವಿಕಲ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಸುಮಾರು ಅವರಿಗೆ ಎದುರಿಸುತ್ತಿರುವಂತ ಒಂದು ಏನು ಸ್ಥಿತಿಗತಿ, ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಕಾಯ್ದೆ ಮಾಡಿದೆ ರೈಟ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್, ಆದ್ರೆ ಅನುಷ್ಠಾನಗೊಳ್ಳುವಲ್ಲಿ ಅದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಅಂಗವಿಕಲ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೆ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಮುಟ್ಟಬೇಕು, ಅದು ಒಂದು ಫ್ರೇಮ್ ವರ್ಕ್ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಇರಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವಂತ ಒಂದು ಫೋರ್ತ್ ವೇ ಫೌಂಡೇಶನ್ನ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ ನನಗೂ ಶಾಲೆ. ಅದರೊಳಗೆ ಸಮುದಾಯ, ನಾವು ಆಕ್ಚುಲಾಗಿ ಮೂರು ಹಂತ ದಾಟಿವಿ. ನಾವು ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಏನಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ SDMC ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಟಿ ಸಮುದಾಯ ಆ ಮಕ್ಕಳನ್ನ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ನೋಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು, ಅದು SDMC ಇರ್ಬೋದು, BPO ಅಂಗವಿಕಲ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಗಳಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಅದು ಒಂದು ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಒಳಗೆ ಸಮುದಾಯ ಪಾತ್ರ ಏನಿರಬೇಕು ಮೊದಲ ಹಂತ. ಎರಡನೇ ಹಂತ ಶಿಕ್ಷಕರಿಗೆ ಯಾಕಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಸಬಲೀಕರಣ ಆಗಲಾರ್ದೆ, ಅವರಿಗೆ ಬಲಿಷ್ಠ ಆಗಲಾರ್ದೆ ನಾವು ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೆ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಕೊಡ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ಸಮನ್ವಯ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಕೊಡ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಸೊ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಎರಡನೇ ಹಂತ, ನಾವು ಮೊದಲ ಹಂತದೊಳಗೆ ನಾವು ಧಾರವಾಡ ಜಿಲ್ಲೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ, ಎರಡನೇ ಹಂತ ಉತ್ತರ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದೊಳಗೆ ಹಲವಾರು ಜಿಲ್ಲೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ, ಈಗ ಮೂರನೇ ಹಂತ ನಮ್ಮದೇ ಆದಂತ ಒಂದು ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲ, ರೆಗ್ಯುಲರ್ ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅಂಗವಿಕಲ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೆ ನಾವು ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಒದಗಿಸಬೇಕು, SRP ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ರೆಡಿನೆಸ್ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್, ಆ ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಅದು ಒಂದು ಶಾಲೆಗೆ ಬರುವಂತ ಮೊದಲು ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಸದಾ ತಯಾರು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವಂತ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ. ಆ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ಮೂರು ವರ್ಷ ನಡೀತಾ ಇದೆ ಈಗ ನಾವು ಮುಂದೆ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಇದು ಕೋವಿಡ್ ಗಂಡಾಂತರ ಬಂತು. ಸೊ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಸಮುದಾಯ ಪಾತ್ರ ಏನಿರಬೇಕು, ನಮ್ಮ ಫೋರ್ತ್ ವೇ ಪಾತ್ರ ಏನಿರಬೇಕು, ಆಮೇಲೆ ನೀವೆಲ್ಲ ತಜ್ಞರ ಪಾತ್ರ ಏನಿರಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಚರ್ಚೆಯೇ ಇವತ್ತು ಮೊದಲ ಹಂತ. ಇನ್ನೂ ನಮಗೆ ದಾಟಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಹಲವಾರು ದಂತ ದಾಟಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕು, ಆದರೆ ಇವತ್ತು ನಾವು ಒಂದು ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡಿಟ್ಟೀವಿ, ಒಂದು ಪ್ರಥಮ ಹಂತ ಪ್ರಥಮ ಹೆಜ್ಜೆ ಇಟ್ಟೀವಿ. ಮುಂದೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾ ಇನ್ನು ಹಲವಾರು ಹೆಜ್ಜೆಗಳ ದಾಟೋಣ. ಈಗ ನಮ್ಮ ಮುಖ್ಯಸ್ಥರಾಗಿರುವಂಥ ಡೈನಾ ಜೋಸೆಫ್ ಮುಂದೆ ನಮ್ಮ ದಾರಿ ಏನು, ನಾವು ಮುಂದೆ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಕಾರ್ಯಾಚರಣೆ ಇರಬೇಕು, ನಿಮ್ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಏನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಒಂದು ಚರ್ಚೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಓವರ್ ಟು ಡೈನಾ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.
Thank you, Mr. Naranjan. That was so comprehensive. And like always, you have, I think the last word should be yours. So I won't take much time in terms of, I just want to explain what we do and why we are going on this journey for the webinar. I don't know if you remember, you told me only two things 15 years back when I decided to start Fourth Way. One, never become a parallel organization and don't focus on thing that is be comprehensive, and I think we have stuck to that one big advice that we've never become a parallel organization. We've always worked in hand in hand with all the departments, and we've tried to become create solutions for the state itself. So that was a big learning from you. I was very young, but I took it very seriously, and that is something that has been cardinal to the journey of Fourth Way Foundation and the evolution of Nanugoshale. So we are very much working with the system, and all our projects and solutions are scalable. We don't create anything that is only exclusively ours. We've always tried our best to share and give away to the disability sector and the government in specific. To something that you just said right now, post-COVID. We have calling it post-COVID, while our inherent problems have always been that we have never lived up to our ambitions of being inclusive, or forget even the inclusion of children with disabilities, but even normal children. We have not come to the levels where we were even aspiring to be working in the norms that were set out. So we are with you on it. So post-COVID is mostly because as it is, children, their education, RTE, CWS, and all of them are falling through the cracks. With COVID as another layer of complications, this might really lose focus. So our emphasis right now is also to ensure that we don't fall through the cracks, especially the needs of the children who are the most vulnerable in the category of children, the CWS and the children with needs. And since they are most vulnerable and they're most ignored in many sense, it is a definite that past this whole COVID experience of us, we might just have, we will go back to 20 years before and where we were. So we don't want that to happen, because the disability sector has made a good journey in the last 20 years. In 15 years, we've done something. We don't want to lose that the journey and the struggle, and again go back to where we started. So this is our main focus. Quickly, this webinar is about solutions and wanting to create solutions together. So it is a request to the entire sector of community organizations, the DPOs, people who are working as professionals with children with disabilities, any specialty that you might have, to come voluntarily come forward and say, here are our suggestions. As much as we are very passionate and want to get our stuff worked out, I think we have to come to a consensus to be able to create something as a solution for the scale, for the state, for various departments who have set out to solve this issue. And in the journey is our need for emphasizing the need for children with disabilities and their inclusion in many aspects. Like Niranjan sir was saying, Dr. Reju was saying, Mr. Basaras was saying, even our ramps are not in place, our toilets are not in place. We don't have basic water facilities for care and safety during COVID. Opening of schools is something we want, because nutrition is an important factor. Children will in the process fall into, already we are looking at child abuse, early marriages happening. All of that is a complication over complication in the lives of the children. And in all of this inadequacies that we already have, we need to come together to say these are quick solutions and let's enforce it. Because I am seeing a lot of openness across departments, across people who are wanting to come together to, but they don't have solutions. They're looking at people to come forward and create those. So we are willing to, we are willing to actually put together a recommendation for it. While Nanugoshale itself has in the last 3 months created a SOP, Standard Operating Procedure, for children in government schools. I'm repeating myself, this is not for any special school process. This is not for any specific disability. This is not for anybody who claims that they have their breakthroughs in handling one particular disability. Here we are looking at scale, we're looking at all disabilities and the complexity of the government education system. And for that, we have come up with something called a standard operating procedure to enable these children to be in the schooling system thus far. And for the benefit of everybody listening, I will run through quickly three, we are calling it as three buckets or three baskets where you can sort of look at the issues and from your end be able to address it in specific. So these three buckets will let you understand what is it that is required for all children, especially children with disabilities, to be able to be in a government school in a safe surrounding and enable learning. So the first bucket is quickly a child-centric. Niranjan sir was very bang on when he said it is a child-centric focus that you have to take when you're considering that children are going back to schools or they are not able to go to school because they're most vulnerable populations and they have to be held back for a few months. Even when the school is open, our children need to be kept back because easily they can get the disease and also the cure is not easily processable for them because of the complexities they hold. So child-centric approach is the first thing that all players need to look at. And in that, we have a subcategory of 405. I will just list it, no time for explanation. Probably the next webinar will make clear all of this. So under child-centric, we're looking at care, the care for children with special needs. We're looking at safety. We're looking at abuse because they will be either in the house or in the schools without facilities. So that is a clear thing. Neglect. Child-centric problem is neglect of these children. While there are 100 other things to handle, a child with a special need might just go neglected. These are not new. These have already been happening, but it will just be coupled or it will multiply because of the process. Then we're looking at learning. Learning will get a big setback. Children with disabilities and whatever is available as solutions right now are not at all inclusive. We are looking at basic things like even readability of a text cannot be enlarged on these websites. Basic features are not being looked at. So even the learning is going to be an issue. Then we are looking at nutrition. When you're looking at child-centric problems, these are the wide problems that you have to consider while you create solutions for children going back into the schooling system. The second bucket is the learning-centric, that is the school-centric issue. And in that, I will call out the subsections that we have identified and we've already created SOPs for. One is the teacher training. We have enough resources. Like we heard the three speakers speaking. There are enough resources in terms of IERTs, BIERTs, VRW, MRW, URWs, the physiotherapists. There is a bunch of people who are dedicated to this and take a pay scale from the government for this. We have to see how we can utilize them. Like Niranjan sir just said now, SDMCs are important. How do we utilize it and customize it at the grassroots level is also a key factor. So when you're coming to the learning-centric issues, we're looking at teacher training and teacher sensitization of children returning back. We are looking at content dissemination. We have to create now new contents to be, if you're looking at, everybody's talking about solutions on internet, via access, radio, TV. While we create it, we also have to understand what is the content we are creating for children with special needs. Accessibility of this content. From our basic dipstick survey, we have realized that only 40% of the children are connected by phone, or internet or WhatsApp, only 40% of the population of children have connectivity on these things. How are we going to disseminate? We are hearing so many solutions of people creating online courses and being able to disseminate, but where will the connectivity happen? Because only 40% is being connected on these mediums that we think are urban solutions. Then the last is dissemination. If you're looking at long-term viable mass media programs, TV and radio might become a solution for our children in the rural, because we primarily work in the very rural, the semi-urban, and we are talking about slums. This is the category of children who will be most neglected. And for them, what is our solution? So I think our solutions need to be created with this in mind, this category of children. And that's when we become inclusive in our approaches. So the second bucket is nearly the learning and the school focus bucket. Third is the care-centric bucket. So the first we are talking is child-centric. Second is the school-centric or teacher-centric bucket. And the third is the care-centric bucket. Care is specifically focused for children with disabilities. There we are looking at the parent who needs to be sensitized and to be able to handle this and understand learning is an importance. Because one example of Nanugoshale is we've had children who come basically on their fours or parents carried them 3 years back into our centers. Today are walking around, running around because of the support we've given, physiotherapy, all of those support systems that we had given. Children in 3 years have already started to walk and move around and become functional. And now we're looking at schools closed or care being not available. They will slide back very quick because they're children with special needs. And how do you ensure that this care-centric program is continued? That means the parents are able to give the same care at home. We're looking at peers. They had made friends in the classrooms because we are working in a very inclusive setup. We were not working as a special school. So how the peers can keep in touch and keep their physiotherapy happening, learning happening, all of that is something we have to look at. Third is the systemic support. Systemic support is what Dr. Niranjan and Dr. Reju and all were talking about. They will manage to enforce some level of inclusion for CWSN is how we understand. And we are all going to do our bit to enable it. The last is the enforcement of all of this. We have to enforce this at some level, that which means that as practitioners are working in this or dedicated to the cause, there is a level of enforcement that we will have to bring in. And this will have to be devised particularly for your own organizations and your specific work. So these are the three buckets. I think in the next webinar, if we have one coming, the coming month, we are having the same dates is what we are looking at. We will brief you on all of this and get experts like Dr. Niranjan to come forward and show you how this is practically possible at grassroots levels and get other experts of various disabilities to be able to give you solutions as well. So these are my broad SOP standards that we've set when you're looking at a child and the child's return in a COVID time back to any public program or school or learning process. So with this, I will quick close what I have to say, sir, because we'll open up. We are good. We are exactly looking at 12:30 now. We've kept time. All of you have addressed all the points that we are requested for and all of us have kept time. We are open for another 10-15 minutes of questions. We can open the chat box and I will enable. I don't know if Mr. Basavaraj is here. Dr. Reju has definitely left. I think Dr. Niranjan, it'll all be shot at you right now. So possibly we will have some answers. We will pitch in and try to give some solutions. And also there are a lot of experts who are logged in, who are also working in the sector. And if they want to speak up, we are open to it. I'll moderate this for a bit now. So thanks everybody for joining in. Your questions can be shot to the chat box or you can raise your hand. There's a raise your hand feature on Zoom. Please put your hand up in the chat box. We'll let you speak for a bit. Anybody now? Haley, sir, can you speak up, please?
Hello.
Rajana, sir. Hello. Rajana, sir. Can you hear me? Yes, sir, please. Yeah. Thank you for joining us. We are very honored to have you on the call. You have been from the beginning, so go ahead and ask us the questions.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you for arranging this meeting. I'm happy that. So, thanks for the Ravi and you. And other people.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hey, listen.
So, first of all, you read about the hearing impaired. Now the number is increased. That is true. Okay. So you have to focus more on them. Hello.
Yes, sir. Kelpa, there. You're very clear. Clearly.
Yeah. Second thing. So what you write pre-PICO, COVID, and now the situation is same for the children with disabilities. Okay, Mr. Niranjan has explained that. And Dr. Ajay has explained around 90,000 children are enrolled in the normal schools. Okay, around 204 blocks. Each block, 400 children one BRT has to cover around 100 children. Now, Basaraj sir is explained about the department is has no human resource. VRW, MRW and VRWs. Okay. My concern, I don't know why you are not invited the director of disabled directorate. Okay. You have to include them in all other meetings. So they have to ask their human resource to enroll and prevent dropouts and participation of children with disabilities in schools. That's their responsibility also. So far, they are not involving in inclusive education. I don't think so. Why they are not? I don't think they are concerned. They are thinking they are not concerned to the issues. Okay. And DDRC also one of the best resource in the state. DDRC, District Disability Rehab Centers. So these are the technical resources available in the state to provide therapy, speech therapy, physiotherapy, and orientation, mobility, special education, counseling, and preparation of assistive devices and maintenance of assistive devices. This is one more resource available in the state. We have to make use of that. That is a technical resource. And also we have RBSK and DEIC. And then MP MLA money is only kept to purchase assistive devices. Okay, that's also one of the major resource, financial resource. We have to make use of that. Okay. One thing, disability is a technical issue and cross-cutting issue and sectoral issue. Now, recently after 2016 Act, they included other disability also. So, we have to say it's a medical issue also. Okay. So, this is my concern. And we have to have a lot of convergence with the, department, our department is, they have to play major role on this inclusive education as well as early interventions. So they have the, they are the center of the program. Okay, thank you.
Sure, sir. This is just the beginning of these discussions.
Yeah, exactly.
Due to time limit, this is all we could accommodate. Your the departments are lined up in the next to come. And it will also be done with Dr. Niranjan in the context so we don't miss out in any of these bodies that are important for implementation at scale. And
yes.
The invite has also come to your office, just for clarification. So, and the personal invite is definitely from our end because of the kind of contributions you make to the sector. Anybody else? Doctor, you want to say something?
Yes, I am Nagaraj. Can I speak?
Yes, sir. Tell me, sir.
I am Nagaraj, President of Karnataka State Disability and Caregivers Federation.
Yes, sir.
And of course, my son, who is also one of the office bearers, is here. And G.N. SSV, he is also here.
Yes, sir.
The main thing, I am very much, perturbed for a long time. And especially now after this corona, impact, it is much more, it will be a much more of a problem. That is, the number of persons passing SSLC is a very crucial thing for anything about disabled, for their employment and for the rehabilitation and various other things. It's a very crucial thing. And that has stagnated for a long time, I feel. And therefore, in the pre-COVID situation itself, it was a very serious problem. And post-COVID, if we don't give particular attention, then this percentage of pass in SLC may drop very seriously, or it may get lower. And that will become a problem for anything. You see, any seat in higher education, for which we are demanding reservation, they will be kept unfulfilled. And also, the jobs also need minimum SLC, even for the lowest of the posts in government and even in private sector. Therefore, if they don't pass SLC, they will all this reservation that we have fought for will go waste. Therefore, the question of making every disabled student to attend the school and to pass out in the various classes and classes, and then come to SSLC and pass in SSLC. All these things are very very tasks, and we have to split that into different stages and take that up with government and also our civil society organizations. We should all together say join to see that the pass in SSLC increases to the extent that all the possible say all the disabled students can pass out of SSLC, disabled say persons can pass out of SSLC. This should be our aim, and we should try to reach how many have passed out of SSLC in that particular age group. Therefore, this kind of index, we should have an index, educational index of disabled people, and which kind of disability is weaker in education. All these things we should have a kind of an educational index. This is what I propose.
Sure, sir. Sure. Sukanya ma'am, is she here? Because she was generally mentioning about how children fall out of the general schooling system. Normal children also fall out in a situation like this. Ebola and Nipah and all of that are examples that they have recorded in different countries. So this is also going to affect our children. Forget the SSLC, where will they even attend the normal schooling is going to become a question. So Dr. Niranjan, is there something that you want to bring about? Is there an index for performance of children with the disabilities anywhere in your knowledge?
So far, I have not really seen any such, kind of attempt. I think it's a very good point to, kind of basically, see, when I talk about inclusive education, all efforts should be made to make those children on par with, all other children. And of course, I appreciate one of the important points raised by Mr. Nagaraj, to bring some kind of credibility in the entire system, at least making children to, finish the matriculation examination becomes very, very, important and becomes a good indicator. And also, particularly it helps, in terms of rehabilitating them, certainly demanding more, opportunities for their livelihood, sustainability, all becomes really very important. And whatever the Karnataka State Secondary Examination Board is, doing now in terms of assisting, providing, a helper and all these things, that is fine. But if you are able to focus, I think probably the centrality of all these interventions depends on the teacher. Teacher has to identify, and teachers play a very important role in the learning process, creating such kind of an enabling environment, and also providing additional support. Certainly all of us agree with one common thing, that these children need additional supports, extra care. That's the reason that even in the new act we said the children who need more, I think that is the kind of understanding. So therefore, I think if it boils, everything boils down to that level. So how do we really, motivate our teachers, to take these, so that children will transit from one stage to another, say from primary to secondary, secondary to higher secondary. I'm not arguing that, children should stop at 10th standard. Of course, that should be one of the very important benchmark, so that, that is sometimes becomes motivation, and also it becomes, a eligibility to get various other, support system within the, larger socio-economic and political system for more sustainability and more, independent, life. So from that point, I really appreciate, and very good. The earlier speaker mapped all the resources. I think probably that kind of an exercise is very, very important. We have, of course, there are resources available, but the question is, how do we use at least the existing resources to the optimum level to see visible research, results is also an issue that we need to address. I agree with them.
Thank you, Nagar sir. Thank you, Niranjan, Dr. Niranjan.
Hello. Yes.
We have 10 more minutes for the questions. Yes.
Yeah. This is Savita here.
Hello.
Savita, speak up, please.
Yeah. I'm from an organization called Vivida.
Okay.
We are a small NGO with special educators. Of course, we focus on visual impairment. But my question was, how can we be involved to be a resource to help out the situation? If we could do anything as special educators, we would be more than happy. So how do we reach out?
We are, Ravi will communicate. You can clearly keep track of our activities through the website. We will definitely open up a little space where you can register with your resources and come forward with your solutions. All solutions are welcome. And at some point, we will even get back to you on how an association is possible at the state level or whatever need levels are there. We will map even the need levels at for scale and implementation. And we'll get back to you, Savita ma'am.
Thank you.
Madam, kindly leave your phone number and your contact details, please, in the chat. So that, madam, kindly leave your details in the chat. We will get back to you.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Ms. Badami. Yes, Ms. Vada.
Can I speak?
Yes.
Can I speak?
Yes.
Hello. First of all, thank you for organization such a wonderful session. It was very, very insightful from all the speakers. Jotted down so many points and really helpful. Also, I wanted to thank a very nice statement I picked up from Sukanya ma'am's talk. I like the term she mentioned, children with vulnerabilities, because it covers a very umbrella term with so many different children with needs which that are there for the children. Also, I would like to ask, I don't know whom to approach. Actually, we are a foundation from Maharashtra, Pune, a small organization right now. We work on grassroots level children with vulnerabilities, with different vulnerabilities. So, whom do I approach? Not only in my state, for my state level, but we are trying to also go into other states and work on grassroots levels. So with awareness of different types of needs of children and identifying their needs and then how to work on them. So we are trying to work on that level. And also I wanted to, we just mentioned that there are a lack of ramps in schools or other places where they are needed. So it is not only that for ramps to enter the premises, but also if there is a building premise, then how to go if the children, if we are having an inclusive setup, that there are children in different classes with needs. So if it's a building in a buildings kind of setup, so how do the children get up to their classes and all those things? So how do we reach to the administration and put up our points that how you can help these children. So it's not easy for us to put this across to the administration. It's very difficult for them, us to put and them to accept it, because they are all government aided schools and all. So whenever we tell them something, they say that we'll have to put this application to the government. And then when government approves it, only then we can take a step forward. So how do we reach this point where we can try and make them implement things what we feel will be helpful for the children? Thank you very much.
For universal design and accessibility, there are documents that you can access online which give you a very detailed account of what is required to make public spaces, schools accessible, the Universal Design Accessibility Document. There are various websites which also provide you, especially in Maharashtra, we know of various organizations and their websites which clearly define what needs to be done to make schooling and, facilities accessible for children. So these are my two bits, but definitely I think the internet is a good place for you to search for your local help, and all of this is available, ma'am. If you need any specific advice, you can reach out to certain bodies that we will list at the end of this chat, or on our websites you can connect with. There is a space called Nevertheless on Facebook, which also puts up all these details occasionally. I hope I answered that. And another question? Rukmini ma'am somewhere was putting her hand up.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yes, ma'am. Please shoot your question.
But I just wanted to ask one simple question. I feel it's very essential. One is, can we focus more on differentiated method of education? Differentiated method of education, especially for so many of these in-service training, many teachers come to us. We find a lot of knowledge is needed for them. They are willing to learn. They are willing to work with the children. So when we have 20 children in the class, we just cannot expect. I don't want to waste time. We are already, I think, quite late. But I just wanted to tell you that has been introduced very much. I believe in that. And it helps. The second point which I have to make is our curriculum itself, how it is, has to get modified to some degree. And there are many aspects to be considered when we are doing it. The ecological, etiological aspect, which is there in the curriculum, has to be sometimes modified so the child can learn the same concept quite easily. And I feel there are a lot of work to be done regarding attitudinal changes in the teachers also. They are doing a wonderful job. I think we can support them, or we just see whatever we can do to make them feel good about what they're doing. But at the same time, we make sure the children can learn. So I don't want to go beyond that. But if you all want any help from me on a differentiated teaching method, I can sort of give you some tips. I can even sit and write a manual for you. I would love to do that as a kind of a help. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you for bringing those points. It is part of the document that's being created. I know Dr. Reju at SSA is very clearly looking at the differential learning methodologies. Also, we're like you said, the teacher training programs, they are working on curriculum with the Azim Premji Foundation, and this is added into that. We have a long way to go. Like we said, our ramps are not in place, our toilets are not in place. While we are getting all of that in place, I think we should get all those good teachers, like you said. We have also found that there are a lot of essentially good people who want to contribute and be available and have a passion to work here. Just that they are not capacitated. They don't have the skill sets. Their willingness is there, but they technically don't know or are not empowered technically to do it. So that is a state problem as well. So let's all ensure that all of these points are there when they consider these topics for discussion. Thank you so much for joining in.
Kindly do get in touch with us, madam, because we look forward to working on the specific topics which you said, madam. Thank you.
I would definitely do that.
Do write to us, madam. Do write to us, please. Thank you.
Thank you. I will. Thank you so much. It's a great, great morning. We all learned so much. I've taken so much of so many points from you people.
Thank you, madam. Thank
have
you.
More of it. Please organize more of this.
We will have it, madam. We'll have it.
Thank you so much. Thanks.
Is that a good note for us to close on? We have 2 minutes left. Please organize more of it. We will be glad to do that. I think we will take that as the last word for today's webinar. I'm sure a lot of people want to ask a lot of questions. It is not fair to keep all of you waiting anymore. We had a good participation with over 150 people who joined in. All of them very important people. And we don't intend to keep you all any longer, but we will send out messages to all the databases for a repeat of this in a month to come. We'll also have to do a lot of grassroots preparation to get this going. So Can we officially close today's webinar? Would be nice to hear from all of you on a show of hands. Okay, a lot of people are saying thank you. Thank you. Yes. Okay, and on that note, let's close. Dr. Niranjan, are you here?
Yes. Thank you very much. I think probably we will continue this.
Yes.
And let us work together to make a difference.
Thank you so much. Sukanya ma'am, are you here? I don't think she did have to, she had to leave. So on behalf of all the speakers, I thank all of you for your time and we look forward to more fruitful conversations. Thank you.